Welcome back to the program. If you're just joining us, this is the second part of Bottomline Africa right on KTN News. And tonight, we're going to discuss more about Zimbabwe, a country that has about 13 million plus people. We're going to talk about what the future holds or what the future will look like for Zimbabwe post-Robert Mugabe. With me in studio, our political analyst, Mark Bichachi. We also have Javas Bigambo, who's a governance expert. Kefo Jijo, I'm going to talk to him as well. He is an advocate. He also doubles up as a political analyst. But before that discussion, allow me to cross over to Harare, Zimbabwe, where Conrad Monawashe, a journalist based in Zimbabwe's capital, is... I'm going to engage him shortly. Of course, he was instrumental yesterday, giving us that breaking news after Robert Mugabe tendered his resignation. And Conrad, good evening. If you could hear me, apparently this is a fresh day. It's a different day. Yesterday, of course, Mugabe tendered his resignation. And today, talk us through about that big welcoming back of Emmerson Mnangagwa back to Harare.
Yes, so the president, Emmerson Mnangagwa, arrived in Harare late afternoon, and he was briefed by political party officials about what was happening in the country. So in his speech, addressing the masses that had gathered at the ruling party, ZANU-PF headquarters in Harare, his speech was telling in that he announced that he already met President Zuma of South Africa, the president of Ethiopia, and former president of Tanzania, Jakaya Kikwete. So he's actually doing some diplomatic offensive while he was still out of Zimbabwe. So he also said that he was pledging to be a peasant. He was trying to re-engineer and to reinvent himself. The fact that people said that he was involved in many kind of atrocities in the country.
Yes.
Trying to reinvent himself and trying to bring a new profile about himself.
Yes. Now Conrad, sorry to cut you short. Yes, Conrad, sorry to cut you short. Part of his speech, he did indicate that, you know, as much as he was talking to the people there, he told them what they are witnessing is a new and unfolding full democracy. This is a man just 16 days ago, he was fired as a vice president, but now he's a president, you know, in waiting. He has started to sound presidential, right?
Yes, it's not only trying to sound presidential, because he's been known as a very hard man, and accused of having been part of Mnangagwa's implementing bomb, you know, for some of the atrocities that happened in the Machakos and Midlands area. So he's trying to say, look here, I was not part of that, without making reference to that. He's trying to show that I'm democratic, I'm appealing, and I'm somebody who can accommodate every person, despite their color, creed, or political affiliation. Also telling his speech is that he promises, apart from promising unfolding democracy, he promised economic growth, unity, and job creation. And also something that Mugabe didn't want to hear, re-engagement with the international community, because he says we call for cooperation with SADC, with Africa, and the international community. And we know that he was also a part of the team that was encouraging the fired finance minister, former finance minister Patrick Chinamata, to engage the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, bilateral creditors, and multilateral creditors, among others, so that they can probably get a similar package from those. So he reiterated that we need to cooperate with the rest of the world, and
yes,
so that we can access international capital, that then we can get concessional funding for infrastructure development and otherwise. He also thanked the Zimbabwe Defense Forces for the manner in which they handled the process.
Yes.
It's so telling in that he said he was in constant touch with the military commanders. He tried to take ownership of this change, to try to show that it was not just thinking of the military, because he knows that if everybody thinks that it was the military who took president out of power and then just Putin, you appear as a stooge of the military, but he doesn't yes. want to appear like that.
Yes,
he
Conrad, clearly, yes, Conrad. Yes, clearly he held.
I was directing operations from behind the scenes. So he's trying to take ownership of this revolution instead of just being a stooge of the military. So this is what happened, and the people who were, not only the people who were running, but also everywhere in town, they were quite happy with this speech.
Yes. Conrad, like one final question. It seems you have a lot of details about Zimbabwe. One final question, Conrad, and very briefly, in 30 seconds, there's something interesting he mentioned in his speech there. He said the reason as to why, he traveled out of the country is because he feared for his life. And he spoke about someone trying to poison him in Zimbabwe. When did that exactly happen? Very briefly.
It happened on the 12th of August whilst he was it's not very clear whether he was poisoned right at the function at in the southern part of the country when he was attending a rally in Gwanda. So, but that's when he felt it. So it's not very clear whether he was poisoned at the rally or he was traveling towards the rally. So it happened on the 12th of August, and then eventually he was airlifted to South Africa for treatment. And he also said 2 hours after he was fired from Gaza, he got wind that they were about to assassinate him, up to eliminate him. So that's why he took that tactical retreat.
Thank you very much, Conrad, for that comprehensive update from Harare, Zimbabwe. Conrad Monawashe is a journalist based in Harare. Now, let me return you back to our studio discussion. Now, let me begin with Mark Bichache. Now, Mark, of course, you've visited Zimbabwe before. This is a country that has faced, sanctions, international. Of course, they're struggling to get back the international legitimacy there. They are, of course, once a breadbasket of not just the 13 million plus Zimbabweans, but for the whole SADC region there in the southern part of the country. But they're now, of the continent, but they're now clearly struggling to even feed themselves. Can you perhaps give us a rough picture of the potential that Zimbabwe has and what Robert Mugabe has clearly denied Zimbabweans?
Zimbabwe has many great potentials, and as always, I like to start with the people of Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe has one of the most educated populations we have in Africa. The education system was quite robust. In fact, a lot of southern African countries rely on Zimbabwean labor to run their economies, both in terms of the manual work that is done in countries such as Botswana, but also in professional capacities in both Botswana and South Africa. So the Zimbabwean population is an asset that the Zimbabwean nation has. The second asset the Zimbabwean nation has is vast tracts of land that are arable. In fact, the entire country is quite green and quite agriculturally viable, with huge tracts of land. Of course, with a population of 13 million for a country of that size, they have a nice population to area to surface area ratio. Therefore, they have enormous potential in terms of agriculture. The other potential that they have as a nation is tourism. They have great rivers and great lakes there that are quite attractive. And then it's also a very hilly, a very mountainous, a very scenic country, in the sense that if you visit Zimbabwe, actually, it is like you're almost at every 10 kilometers or so is like a viewpoint. You know how when you're driving to Nakuru, you can see 2-3 viewpoints? In Zimbabwe, it's quite different. The country is hilly, yes. It has valleys. So it's a very beautiful country. And then, of course, the natural resources that it has. So Zimbabwe has enormous potential. And what is going to be very interesting for me to watch is how many of the Zimbabweans living in the diaspora will want to repatriate. And that could be a hidden amount of resource that could come into Zimbabwe by way of transferring funds they've saved and had in other countries and coming to invest back in their country.
Actually, there are 3 million plus Zimbabweans who are living outside Zimbabwe. Now, Jarvis, as a governance expert in Mnangagwa, do you believe that Zimbabwe, with all this huge potential Mark Bichache has been talking about, do you think with Mnangagwa they're ready now to tackle?
Well, I would want to be a bit careful and exercise restraint in my optimism of the kind of take-off that Zimbabwe is likely to witness following the resignation of President Robert Mugabe. Now, I say restraint because I call what has happened in Zimbabwe yesterday to be a false kind of liberation. I call it false because the kind of upstaging that has faced Robert Mugabe is as a function of sibling rivalry within ZANU-PF. And I would wonder how an oppressor would come out himself to try and demonstrate that he can liberate the oppressed. You see, the military, yes, moved in to try and liberate Zimbabwe, mm-hmm. but as a matter of fact, the military itself, the army itself, has been very complacent of the kind of economic and political decline mm-hmm. that Zimbabwe has faced during the reign of President Mugabe. Mm-hmm. Now look, the kind of thrill, celebration that was witnessed in Zimbabwe yesterday and even today
yes.
is not very different from that which was witnessed at the Rufaro Stadium in 1980 when Robert Mugabe took over the reins of power. But what happened? Look, the individual today who was poised to take over the reins of power from Robert Mugabe is the same individual who in 1983 was the spanner boy or a leader in government under Mugabe mm-hmm. who oversaw the massacre of over 20,000 people in Matabeleland. And he has been in government again and again throughout all these years. And in fact, what we are seeing is just the change of the Mugabe leadership and yes. grace, mm-hmm. but the system remains the same. And that's why I think it would be very different, situation in Zimbabwe, or rather even the hopes of the Zimbabweans should be should be very cautious. Mm-hmm. Look, some people have come in to say that what is happening in Zimbabwe is akin to what happened to Kenya in the year 2002. Now, it's very different because in Kenya, upon the exit of President Moi, we had also the exit of KANU. Here we are seeing the exit of Robert Mugabe, but ZANU-PF remains entrenched. And in fact, the system itself and its structures remain intact. So we are not likely to witness a transformation that is very dramatic under the leadership of President Mnangagwa.
Actually, these are the same sentiments shared by some members of the opposition in Zimbabwe. The key word they normally use is that they are cautiously, optimistic. Now, Kefa, before I come to you, very quickly, Mark, you talked about change. As in democracy, you've talked about, change is always good. Can you perhaps emphasize or explain that?
I will remind Jarvis Mugabe about one Raul Castro and Fidel Castro. Fidel and Raul were brothers. They come with the same DNA package, okay? Mm-hmm. They were in the struggle together. But when Raul Castro took over Cuba, you're seeing Cubans experiencing newer freedoms. What is the point I'm trying to make here? The thing about change in democracy and why democracy is espoused is not that the masses will always choose nice people. It is that every time you change a leader, the leader who's coming in is forced by the circumstance to make concessions that are good for the people. So yes, he may have all that history, but the fact that there is a change is as good as a rest.
Mm-hmm. Now, you see, Mark,
Jarvis, I'll give you 30 seconds to react to that because I want to get to listen to Kefa's comment as well.
Okay.
I'm giving you 30 seconds to react to Mark.
Well, one, I would like to bring Mark to the attention of a very fine text written by a Brazilian called Paulo Freire, titled The Pedagogy of the Oppressed. Mm-hmm. And in understanding the nature, the character of the oppressed, one realizes that the place of education or misinformation mm-hmm. plays a very crucial role in social change that can take place in a society. Mm-hmm. Now, until the oppressed themselves climb the ladder and pursue social and even political or economic change, the circumstances that the oppressor put in place will remain intact. Mm-hmm. And that is why even Steve Bantu Biko of South Africa said that the most potent weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. And today, yes. you realize that the Zimbabweans are not fully liberated merely by the exit of Mugabe. Mm-hmm.
Kefa, I would like to hear your comment on this. Are you siding with Mark? Or actually, let me just pose this question. There are those who are saying that, Mnangagwa is a symbol of a new beginning for Zimbabwe. Do you necessarily agree with that?
Thank you, Yusuf. First, kindly allow me to explain something which I think is very crucial. Mm-hmm. On my position, I do feel that the continuation of a party necessarily does not mean, you know, a continuation of a dictatorial system. Even after the exit, I would like to disagree with Javas a little bit, because even after the exit of the former president Daniel Moi, we realized and we still saw KANU rebranding, and KANU was still vibrant until other political parties came in the scene. But even up to now, we still have KANU as a party on its own.
But KANU was not but in then, power, right?
You know, it's because the flag bearer was out, but mm-hmm. KANU as a party was still in African leaders. Mm-hmm. Was that even when that's subjected to the same process that are subjecting
so basically
people.
You believe there's some elements in Mnangagwa's government that is going to be different. Now, before I come to you, Mark, Javas,
yes.
3 million Zimbabweans, you know, live outside Zimbabwe. And of course, one of the legacies of Robert Mugabe is that, you know, his policies divided families, and that is why some of them, you know, fled the country. Now, all of them want to come back to Zimbabwe. Are you saying their hopes, their dreams, their aspiration are all in vain?
Well, I think it is all right, and we understand them when they are very excited to come back home. I have spoken to some of my friends who are domiciled in South Africa, some in the UK, and some of them are expressing delight in the possibility of coming back home. But some of them, of course, even some academics, are very cautious. Now look, in South Africa alone, we've got close to reimagine a new Zimbabwe.
Has had sanctions.
So that the moment Mugabe exits and another leader comes in, you will see that international community relations will start running to Zimbabwe to strengthen their relationship.
But those who come from the school of thought that, you know, some of these international communities have their interests.
Of course, interests
especially
are...
Especially when it comes to African countries.
Interests are inevitable in all African countries. All these international communities have interests. But you see, the most important thing that you also need to see as a country is what interest do you also have in this relationship? Mm-hmm. Because you cannot exist as alone. Zimbabwe right now needs the international community more than international community, I think, needs it. And another thing to ensure that for Zimbabwe to start operating, they must first work on their, you know, the internal mechanism. They must work on their institution. Zimbabwe has courts that cannot do anything. The courts that operate from the, you know, by the directives of the executive. They must strengthen the institution, the independent commissions they have, so that they start a system where people believe. Do you know, the citizens of Zimbabwe do not even believe in their own system. They do not believe in their own institutions they have. Mm-hmm. So that it's even hard for them to have a credible or a fair, not even election, but a fair or a fair thing, even in court.
Of course, that speech by the president in waiting, that is Emmerson Mnangagwa, part of his speech, he held the discipline of the Zimbabwean army. This is an army that created some sort of a coup. They've not openly said it's a coup, but they didn't fire a single bullet. Do you agree with him?
Well, of course, this is a very interesting time where the military got too close to a coup and then pulled back and then forced. I don't know whether it was a negotiation or a threatened retreat by Mugabe, but either way, the army did play a large role.
Yes.
However, let's remember that Mnangagwa himself is a product of the army. He is a product of the liberation. He came from the trenches. Mm-hmm. So his buddies in the army were doing him a favor. However, we need to realize that whenever you are part of the process of making a king, once the king is crowned, it behooves him to remove the neck of those who he stood on. So are we going to see a situation where he's going to do a big reshuffle within the Zimbabwean army? I think so, because these are the people who brought him to power. To keep himself in power, he has to put people there who do not threaten his power. So I expect that there will be some sort of reshuffle within the army.
Yes.
I also expect that he will begin and try to reward those within the army who brought him to power.
Especially the general. Well said, Mark. Kefa, do you think the military in Zimbabwe should be held?
Neighboring country. And yes. It's a trend going on.
Rega King says, every leader stands out, whether disgraced or referred, though. Pick your choice. And at Joel Kamau says, Uhuru Kenyatta, because he's humble and follows the constitution as expected of him. And Ocheng Victor says, Raila Odinga, I don't think he's the president now. And he says he stands for what he knows is right, even if he's Close Associates, crossover to the other side. It stands for truth and justice to all. Many thanks for your feedback there, although some of them are controversial. And that brings us to the end of our program tonight. This has been Bottomline Africa. Many thanks for watching. My name is Yusuf Ibrahim. Bye-bye for now, and enjoy the rest of the night.